Dave, why don't we start with Mac Miller?
Mm.
Because we got a couple albums. We're going to be talking YG and Travis Scott as well. But Mac Miller is somebody we've talked about in here. We reviewed Divine Feminine, what, 2 years ago? 2016?
Fall 2016, yep.
So it's been a little under 2 years since his last album. And I think we enjoyed his album. I think we said artistically he's a solid artist, kind of in that tier of, you know, he's going to keep making solid records, but maybe not that superstar level. Mm-hmm. But he's had some hard times this year, man. You know,
yeah.
Ariana Grande dumped him and like immediately got engaged to Big Dick Pete Davidson. And then
so weird.
Kind of soon after, he got in some legal trouble with a DUI and a hit and run. So he's had a pretty rough year. How did it play out in this album?
I think, you know, by all accounts, it seems the album came out pretty darn good. I don't know how much of the current events impacted this record. You know, he was in the studio for a while, but yeah, this is definitely the product of that loss, I would say. And I think it came out pretty well. But I mean, what did you think, considering, you know, like a lesser or milder Mac Miller fan than I?
Yeah, anyone that wants to go back and listen to our review of Divine Feminine, you can find that at soundcloud.com/nostalgiapod. I was big into Mac when he dropped Blue Slide Park and some of his mixtapes, but I haven't really been super into his recent work. But I really enjoyed this album. It's a little more, I don't know if melancholy is the right word, but mellow. And it kind of relies more on like keys, orchestras. I got a lot of like a Frank Ocean or like some of the songs kind of sounded Anderson Paaky in a way. I think there's.
Oh, yeah, sure. They had a song on Divine Feminine.
Yeah. I think he's really trying to follow their creative lane right now. And it's a great creative lane to be in, and he pulls it off pretty well. The only thing I think I can say is it did sound a little homogeneous throughout. Some of the songs sounded similar. And I think he delivers the songs really well, but also some of the content, while introspective, I didn't find super intriguing at times, but overall really solid effort. I know you're a bigger Mac fan. Was this what you expected from him at this time, I guess?
No, yeah, I really like this. I mean, you already kind of spoke to it, but Mac Miller came up 9 years ago, long time ago, as a, you know, kind of became the poster boy of, you know, like frat rap, white frat rappers, right? Because he quickly became the most famous one. And that music was fine, but it's, you know, a lot of people really didn't like it. And I actually really don't like listening to it now. I was a big fan of it at the time. But then, you know, his whole progression, the music he's making now is so much
light years,
obviously much better. And, you know, it's really been fun watching this career improve as he's gone. Like, I mean, you could see the seeds of this on like his Maxadelic tape in 2012. And then watching Movies with the Sound Off, his second album, the one after Blue Slide Park in 2013, was like this quantum leap. It's like, oh, wait. Mac Miller's now your favorite rapper's favorite rapper. Everybody fucks with him. Schoolboy Q fucks with him, right? And on Macadelic, you know, he had a Kendrick feature in 2012, for example. He had Joey Badass's first official feature, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, like, he quickly was becoming this ingratiated in, like, mainstream hip-hop, right? And as he's grown, like, I think Good AM, again, was his best record date at the time. I think Divine Feminine isn't as good as this new record, Swimming. But you kind of see like the through line, like Ariana Grande, like was his muse on that one. And now she's his ex muse, something he lost in his life. Mm-hmm. And I think the introspectiveness, like you said, is certainly present. Yeah. Maybe not always super interesting, super, fun to revisit, but I think it's pretty compelling. And, you know, the guy who was a frat rapper and pissing everyone off, just because he's just a moron, right? Now he's like, he just hangs out with Sid and Thundercat. Like, that's what he likes to do. And
hell yeah.
Out on his like 30 pianos that he has, you know? So it's been really cool. He's only 26 too. It's like, he's still young. Yeah. But yeah, I think this record's really cool. There's a lot of fun songs on it. I think Perfecto and Ladders are pretty dope. Jet Fuel I liked. And then Small Worlds was on here. That was from that trio of Lucy's he dropped at the end of May, mm-hmm. right when Pusha T was going after Drake around that time. And yep. I thought that was an interesting choice to keep on this because my favorite record of those three Lucy's was Programs, which is on our Spotify playlist. So check that out if you're mm-hmm. not already following that. And Programs was much more aggressive, you know, just, you know, rappity rap Mac, right? Yep. But I was thinking, I was like, well, I like that song more. It probably wouldn't have fit on Swimming. You know, Swimming, he's more reserved and mellow in his delivery. So, you know, I think sometimes that delivery doesn't always work, which in Defined Feminine, you saw this, where he's, you know, growing a lot as a singer, but he's still not a great singer. So sometimes his vocals can be a little off, but again, mm-hmm. he's always seems to be trying things. So I was, you know, again, pleasantly surprised with now he made a funky ass album. You know, it's really cool.
Yeah, it's funny thinking back to Blue Slide Park and then this album, you know, Blue Slide Park being his proper first album. Up All Night and like Frick Park Market, Party on Fifth Ave, like such a different sound. I think there's elements to those. You know, I think he always kind of like had like brass sections, and I think there were parts of his just musical interest that he's now starting to explore more with these and a much more mature sound, like you said. But you know, Mac Miller I find to be kind of compelling. I was checking out his recent Tiny Desk concert, which I think they put on YouTube this weekend, which was awesome.
Shout out to
yeah, and he's like you said, he's working with people like Thundercat, Schoolboy Q, some people that, you know, Vince. Definitely yep, take a different tone, a different lane in this. And I wonder, I'm really excited to see where his career is going to go, because I think he has potential to make, and probably not on the level of Kendrick Lamar, but kind of in that same vein, something that could use the sound of To Pimp a Butterfly. And if he has something he actually really wants to say, I could see him having like a record that could be a top 10 record in a year.
Yeah. And I agree. And I think what's probably good for him right now is he's famous. He's well known. And he was quite famous pre Ariana Grande, but obviously that really catapulted mm-hmm. him just in terms of casual people knew who he was. Right.
Right.
And now he just exists in a space where the rap game likes him. He's connected mm-hmm. as fuck. He started out as independent, one of the most successful independent artists we've ever had. But then he, you know, kind of played out that. So now he's on Warner, and he's a dependable artist for Warner. So he has a lot of label support. But there's no pressure on Mac Miller. Like this weekend, Mac Miller and YG dropped, and then behind Travis Scott. Travis Scott's Astroworld, this big album that everyone has high expectations for. And Travis Scott's never been more famous. Mm-hmm. You know, with Kylie Jenner and whatnot. And Mac can just exist, and he can make his artsy fartsy project, have the critics like it, have his core fans that are still around like it, and keep doing what he's doing. You know, it's really like low stakes for him in the best possible way. And I think that's great. And I agree. I think with more fine tuning of the lyrics and stuff, I think he can continue to improve, and he's gonna have a long ass career. And crazy that he's been around so long and he's still 26.
Yeah, so, crazy, man.
He's still kind of slept on. A lot of people either stopped listening to him as he started changing because they were more fans of the frat rap, or didn't like frat rap, which is totally defensible stance, and never realized that he got way better and changed. Mm-hmm. So I feel like there's still, you know, fans to be had for Mac.
Yeah, so, I've talked about
work for him.
I've talked about this on the pod, how I got in a brief Twitter back and forth with Hoodie Allen back in our college days, about like 6 or 7 years ago. About this was right after you know, Blue Slide Park came out, and I was saying, you know, I think Mac is better than Hoodie Allen, and Hoodie Allen took exception, and we had a short exchange. But it's funny because we reviewed Hoodie Allen last year, and he was somebody I was out on, and I think he actually started to mature as well. Obviously a different sound, and he still I think holds more to that poppy you know, party-ish sound that Mac has definitely moved away from. But it's nice to see them both maturing and moving up in different ways. Obviously Mac a different level of artist and respect, but just funny to think about.